my new bucket list item. I want to go on an archaeological dig with this organization called Associates for Biblical Research. In case you want to give your pastor a gift. All right, we're going to go. What I want to do to start out is show you some pictures. Pictures are worth at least 1,000 words or more. And I want to show you some pictures. Some of these I took when we were in Israel a couple years ago. Some I, you know, shamelessly got, you know, stole from the internet. This one I got, I took. It's an example of a first century rolling stone tomb alongside Route 6953 in Israel up north. And it gives, so when the Bible talks about a tomb with a stone that rolled, these are pretty unique to the first century as well. So they're all over the place in Israel. They're digging them up all over. So that's, then you're just driving by the road and there it is. I guess I need to turn this on, huh? Sorry. There we go. Sound guys are to be seen, not heard. Okay. There's a close up of it. There's those of you new to our church, if you were expecting, you know, formality and respect for the pastor, you come to the wrong place. Okay. You know, I went and got a doctorate just to feel better about myself, and then they call me dog afterwards, doctor of godology. So that's what that did for me. Okay. There are actually three cutouts in this cave. And there's somebody who didn't die, but she crawled in there anyway. This is an example of one that's closer to Jerusalem. This was probably Herod's family. Herod himself wasn't buried there. But again, you can kind of see how the stone rolled. They had an enclosure and the stone rolled through that. This is what, if you'd gone into a Jewish tomb during the days of Jesus, what it would have looked like. They would have had a slab laid out there for, don't you love coming to church, get to see all this really fun stuff, right? A slab laid out for the body there, covered in linen, and then those boxes are called ossuaries. Those, they'd go back a year later and recover the bones of the deceased person, put them in a box called an ossuary. Now, the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, where Jesus was laid, was a brand new tomb. There are no bodies or ossuaries in that one. All right, this is an archaeological find. They found this, trying to remember what year, about 2006, I think. Might have been more recent than that. It is the box that contained the bones of the high priest Caiaphas, who is mentioned in every gospel account, who was there at the trial of Jesus. Over here is an inscription and a close-up of it, and it says, Joseph, son of Caiaphas. Right there, and Josephus, a Jewish historian, tells us that Caiaphas' nickname was Joseph, or his family name, and so that they found the bones of a 60-year-old man in there, and in his family grave there were several other of these ossuaries that they found. In other words, when the Bible describes a guy named Caiaphas, the gospel writers weren't making it up. This is, what do you think that is? It's the heel bone of an unfortunate crucifixion victim that they uncovered in 1968. And this is the only, despite the fact the Romans crucified thousands of people, this is the only archaeological find that they've been able to find with an actual nail in somebody's foot, in this case, the heel. Usually, not in the case of Jesus, but usually it's a crucified victim, they'd throw in a common grave and they were long lost and forgotten. But this guy was in an ossuary, and that's what his bone looked like. So that's probably, there is olive wood right there, and so they've kind of reconstructed what it would have looked like there. As a result, it kind of messes up your view of crucifixion. How many saw the movie Risen? You notice they had the guy's feet a little bit different. Well, the reason is because of this evidence that they may have crucified him like that, kind of pinned their feet to the side of the cross like that, and so therefore pushing up would have been even more painful. But based on that evidence, it's probably what it looked like. There are two places in Jerusalem that they think Jesus may have been buried. One has really good historical evidence, the other not so much. This is the one not so much. It's a hill. You can see it looks a little bit like a skull. And there was a guy who saw this in the 19th century, and he said, "Hey, that looks like a skull there. I wonder if that was where Jesus was crucified." And so they called it Skull Hill. The guy's name was Gordon, and a bunch of British people bought the property, and they established this place called the Garden Tomb area. It is probably more like where Jesus was buried than where I think he was buried. But if you ever travel to Israel, this is kind of a nice place to reflect on the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. The tombs they found there are actually about 500 years to 1,000 years older than the first century. So I don't think he was, but it's a much nicer place to visit if you want to reflect on that. Now, where I think he was crucified and rose is right back here. This is looking into Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives from the east, so you're east looking west. This is obviously the Dome of the Rock, and over here is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, so that is more a close-up of it in Jerusalem. In first century Jerusalem, again, if you've been at this church, you've seen, you guys still with me? You didn't expect to get an archaeological lesson when you came to church today, did you? But here's why. I want to make this is real stuff. When the Bible writes about resurrection, it's writing about things that these guys experienced. This is more than just, and in no way put it down a Sunday school story. We teach our kids this because it happened, all right? So first century Jerusalem, dominated by the temple area, 40-acre complex. When Jesus shut down the money changers in the temple area, think that. Don't think a little storefront church, okay? 40 acres. That was a whole industry in Jerusalem that he just shut down by power of his own person. All of the money changers would have been here and down here. And so that's the temple area. And then the city walls extended here. And then later on, not too far after the death of Jesus, they came out further. But crucifixions or any execution were always done outside of the city walls. So this area right here is probably, there was a rock quarry there. And Golgotha, of course, you know, it means place of the skull. It can also mean place of beheading or place of the head. And so there was a quarry there. It was probably sunk down. And there was a gate and a couple major roads. And they always crucified people. Why did the Romans crucify people in the first place? Okay, there was a lot of, maximum shame, maximum pain. And so they would crucify them in very public areas where people would walk by and see, and especially in Jesus' case, because they had that nice little sign, this is the King of the Jews, and they were ready to stick it to the Jewish people. They really wanted to do that. So it's most likely here in this area, which was at the time outside of the city. A few years later, it was no longer outside the city. They extended the gates. And that is where the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is today. The reason that we think it's there is because there was, when the Romans came in after the Jews were thrown out in 70 AD and then again in 125 AD, there was the Romans made a shrine here and established a temple to Jupiter and a temple to Venus, I think. I don't think I have that right, but I think it was Jupiter and Venus. Anyway, they knew where the resurrection of Jesus had taken place, and they didn't want Christians to come along and kind of make what they did finally out of a shrine. So they established there a temple to Jupiter, and they put an image of Jupiter there. Well, when the Roman Empire went Christian under Constantine, guess where Constantine's mother went and was told that's where Jesus was crucified, buried. And this is only 300 or so years after the fact. They kind of knew stuff we don't know today, most likely closer to the event. And so they built, that church has been there now for well over 1,000 years, Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It is reputed to be both the place Jesus was crucified and also where he rose again. So here would be the place of crucifixion, place of resurrection. I think, based on some reading I've done, that the place of crucifixion was about 200 feet south of there, but it's in the same general area. So when you're thinking distance from the site of crucifixion to the tomb, you have to think, in terms of, like, you know, really close walking distance. So when they took the body down from the cross and then took him to the tomb, which was in a garden area, we're told, that's where they went. That's the entrance to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, just so you see it. This is what religion does. This is what religion does to places and theology and things like that. You see this ladder here? That is called the immovable ladder. You know why it's immovable? Church of the Holy Sepulchre is owned by three different Christian sects, okay? Roman Catholicism, Eastern Orthodox, and Syriac Orthodox, okay? I think that's the three. I have it written down here, but I don't want to take the time to find it. So, three different denominations. Sometime in about 1850, somebody, and it's opened every day by an Islamic guy, because they can't trust the three different groups to do that, because they've been fighting for centuries over this. In about 1850, somebody put a ladder there, and nobody knew who did it. And because they have this the rule of status quo there, you can't, you know, the Orthodox can't touch what belongs to Catholics, Catholics can't touch what belongs to Syrians, so you can't. Nobody knew who put it there, therefore nobody's going to take it away. Because they don't want to mess it up. There will be big fights if somebody ever takes that thing down. Because nobody knows who put it. You know, some guy, probably like Glenn, decided it's the night I'm going to have a little bit of fun here. Put a ladder, make sure I'm not caught, and then see what happens. Well, what's happened is nobody's touched it for, you know, almost 200 years now. So anyway, that's you see that there, and that's what religion does to stuff. If you're here today because of religion, I hope you rethink that. All right, because religion isn't what this is about, at least in my opinion. That is in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It's reputed to be the rock of Calvary. So you go to the altar, you reach down there, and there is a rock, and you can see both sides of it from other places else. And if it's not the rock, it's really close to, I think, where the actual rock of Calvary was. That is the site of the tomb. And again, archaeologists, there are lots of tombs underneath this church. And there was a garden there at one time. That's why they think it's probably the site where Jesus was crucified. There's the dome. That is called the stone of unction. In other words, the stone that's reputed where they put Jesus to prepare him for burial. That's not the actual stone, believe me. But it's there kind of as a symbol of that event. Okay? And then, if you want to buy something, you go to the Holy Sepulchre store. See, Christians can do this just as well as the first century Jewish people can do it. If Jesus were there, I'm sure he would probably not be all that enamored with that. But it's been there since 1947, Nicholas Shabaita. Pick up a relic. Okay, there you go. Why'd I do that? Because it pleases me, and you can't do anything about it, that's why. John Stott, great Christian writer, said this, Christianity is at its very essence a resurrection faith. The concept of resurrection lies at its heart. If you remove it, Christianity is destroyed. Another writer by the name of John Wales said, the Gospels do not explain the resurrection. The resurrection explains the Gospels. In other words, had there been no resurrection of Jesus, there would have been no reason to write about it. And so the Gospel writers wrote about it because they experienced in one way or another an actual resurrection. This morning with the time left to us, I want to read from Luke the resurrection account. And what I want to do is to say, why did Luke write this? What point was he trying to make? And what difference does it make for you and I today? Why are you here today? Why am I here today? It's a nice day. Could be doing a lot of things, right? But we're here. So why? All right, so let's go to Luke chapter 25. Luke chapter 25. Twenty-four. First verses 5 through 8. Verse 5. You know what? What's that? Yeah, thank you. We're going to start at verse 1. I'm just going to open a real Bible here. Yeah. See, this is what happens when you don't bring a real Bible and you don't do anything else. Here we go, Luke 24. But on the first day of the week, what's the first day of the week? Monday, Sunday. First day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise." And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. All right, so that's Luke's account. All the gospel writers take a little different slant on the resurrection. They all report it. There's different details in each one, and this is how Luke reported. There's amazing consistency, however, as we go through the different resurrections accounts. So what does Luke want us to know about the resurrection of Jesus, and what is important to our lives now? That's what I want you to ask. The first point is this. Jesus keeps his promises, and the Father fulfills his plan. Jesus keeps promises. We see that that when the angels came, and we have the passage there. I'm going to forego it just for time here. As we read this passage, we see the women going to the tomb. Luke doesn't even mention their women until later on. A study of who these women were is a great study in itself. We just don't have time for it this morning. But Luke mentions three. He mentions Mary Magdalene later on, and Joanna, and then the other Mary, the mother of James. Mary Magdalene, despite what everybody thinks about her, was not a prostitute, as far as we know. She did have demons removed from her by Jesus and became a follower. Joanna happened to be related through marriage to a steward who worked for King Herod the Tetrarch. This would be Herod Antipas, not Herod the Great. Those of you who played different Herod roles a few months ago when we did this will remember there are a lot of Herods in the Bible. You need a program to sort them out. This Herod Antipas, who was around during the trial of Jesus, she was married to a guy who worked in his household. And then there was Mary, who was the Mary of the apostle called James the Less, or James the Little. The reason he was called that is because he wasn't James the brother of John, as in James and John. He just wasn't as famous, so that's what's come to him. But his mother was a follower of Jesus, just as he was. And so that's the three women that Luke mentioned. And of course, they are surprised at what takes place. And what does the angel tell them? After the angel says, after the angel gets a little bit sarcastic, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? Huh? He's not here. He's risen. Remember?" Angels crack me up in the Bible. They really do. Because they say stuff you just wouldn't expect. We saw some angelic visits in Acts, and we see one here, and Luke mentions another one. It's like the angel's now lecturing the women. "Remember what he told you when you were in Galilee, that the Son of Man must suffer and be crucified and on the third day rise. Remember that?" He said it a few times. It's like when I ask you, "Hey, remember what I talked about last week?" And you all know right away. Kind of like that. And so Jesus promised that this was going to happen. And he said it several times. And remember, Luke is writing, if you remember this, both his Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts, same writer. He is writing to, see how many, okay, I'll put myself in line. How many remember who Luke addressed his Gospel and the book of Acts to? Go ahead, John. The guy had a Greek name. He addressed it to one individual, though. Theophilus. Theophilus. That means that's Theophilus' name I've ever heard anybody give anybody at all. Theophilus means lover of God. And Luke addressed, and this guy was a Luke himself was a Gentile, too. He's the only Gentile gospel writer. And he addresses it, and he wants Theophilus to know for sure that the stuff he's been told up till now actually happened, and Theophilus can bank on it. So I want to write an orderly account to tell you what's taking place in these days so that you can be sure of your faith. I don't know about you today, but not everybody is sure about this stuff, and Luke wanted to make sure that Theophilus was dead sure about it, if you can forgive the pun there. He wanted him to be absolutely certain, and so he writes about the birth of Jesus, about the life, the ministry of Jesus only gets about six chapters, I think, in Luke. The rest is his birth, a chapter on John the Baptist, and then Jesus going to Jerusalem. It's backloaded to the last week, the events of the last week of his life. All the Gospels are like that, as I mentioned last week. Heavily weighted towards the last week of the life of Jesus. It's more than half the Gospel of John. Isn't that amazing? They all write, wow, somebody wants you bad there, Glenn. All right, they all write, and they backload it that way, and Luke was trying to write an orderly account, so he wants him to be sure of what he's been told, and one of the things he wants Theophilus to be sure about is that when Jesus makes a promise, he keeps it. If he can keep this promise about rising from the dead, well, other promises are really no big deal, right? I mean, you can keep that one. You can probably keep some other promises that you've made. What are some other promises that Jesus made that you can think of, class? It'll return for us. What are some others? Forgive your sins. What are some others? There's a place for us. I'm going to prepare a place for you. If it weren't so, would I have told you that I'm going away and I'm going to prepare it? Seek the kingdom of God and all these things will be at all the stuff you think you need. That you actually do need, then make sure you get it. Don't worry about it. Don't sweat it. Look at the birds over here. They don't, you know, they do what they do. Look, and the Father provides for them, and you are worth much more than many sparrows. What do you think? Think your Father's going to forget about you? How about I am with you always, even the end of the earth? When Jesus makes a promise, you can bet on it that it will be kept. So I don't know what condition you come here today. But my guess is that you've had promises made to you by other human beings that have been broken. You probably have broken promises yourself. And it's very difficult for us to think of somebody who will always come through on what they said. And the message that Luke wants to get to Theophilus through the resurrection of Jesus is that when Jesus makes a promise, it's going to happen. It may not happen in the time frame we want it to happen. It may not happen like we want it to happen or in a way that we would expect to happen. But it's going to happen. Jesus never welches on a promise. Ever. And if he can pull off resurrection like he promised, he can pull off anything else, especially the one about being with you. Second point is this. The resurrection of Jesus will always be met by skepticism. Why? Well, because it's an incredible event. Last year, I gave a sermon called The Logic of the Incredible, and it was from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And all of the gospel writers go out of their way to make sure that they talk about these events as real life, and they define resurrection. So when we say Jesus rose from the dead, here's what we mean. We mean that he died. In fact, when Paul mentions it, he says, I delivered you what I received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scripture, was buried, and that's an important part of it, and it was important that he was buried in a place that everybody knew about in Jerusalem. And then on the third day, he rose again. So that's what's out there. That's what's proclaimed, and they all talk about having seen these events, that this is more than just a fairy tale. This is not something that we would have. It's not something we could have made up. These are things that actually happened. And so Luke writes it, the resurrection of Jesus will always be met with skepticism. Verses 10 through 11 of that passage. Now, it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles, but these words seemed to them an idle tale and they did not believe them. Put yourself in the position of the women for a second here. And if you're a woman here, you can probably do that. How many times do you know that you saw something or heard something in the car engine and you go tell your husband or somebody else about it, the mechanic, and they look at you like, you don't know nothing. Women, anybody experience that? And they're, yeah, look at those hands chewed up there. Yeah! Preach it, Pastor Mike, give them, you know. It was no different then. It is really interesting, and all the gospel writers mention this, that it was the women who hung in there at the crucifixion. John was the only apostle who made it to that event. The other 10, 11 including Judas, they skedaddled in Civil War parlance there. They left. The women hung around there. The women were the three mentioned here as well as another named Salome, who was the mother of James and John. These women were just, they were tenacious in their desire to follow Jesus, and they were the ones who got to be the first witnesses. Now, you've heard me say this before, and if you've heard me talk about the resurrection, the fact that the gospel writers say women discovered this was not something that would have been made up if it had not happened, because it was not to the advantage of Christians living in the first century to say, hey, by the way, women were the first ones to discover the resurrection. That was not an advantage. The only reason that's mentioned is because it happened. And so the women discover it. And so they go back and tell the disciples. Now, these are not the disciples. Like, could in no way, shape, or form be listed as critical of Jesus' ministry, right? These were guys who had been with him. These were guys who heard the same thing the women had, probably heard it more often. Guys, come here. Okay, we're going to Jerusalem. Do you understand that? Yeah, we understand. Okay. When we get there, you guys know, right, what's going on. You guys know that I'm not really popular among the religious elite there, right? Yeah, we know that, man. All right, I'm going to go. We don't think you ought to go. Well, I'm going to go. When we get there, I'm going to be turned over to the Roman officials. I'm going to be beaten. I'm going to be basically dishonored to the extreme. I'm going to be crucified. But on the third day, I'm going to rise again. Do you realize statements like that, you hear everything up until the but? Right? Even though Jesus had said this, they just were not, they could not, they had seen Jesus do so many amazing things. They had seen Jesus put down the scribes and Pharisees and the religious leaders so often, they could not conceive that he was ever going to be gotten the best of. And yet he submitted to this whole thing. When you read the Gospels, you see that it looks like Jesus is in charge from start to finish, just allowing things to happen as they do, which we'll get into in just a little bit. It was the plan of God for this to happen. Luke uses the word must. I must do this. This must happen. The plan of God is being played out here. And so the women come back, and they tell the disciples this, and Luke uses a phrase that it sounded to the disciples like idle talk. Well, this is a very polite way of saying that it sounded to them like these crazy women were out of their mind. That's what it sounded like to them. We've seen him, he's risen. Imagine how you would think if somebody saw you. Just think of somebody who's died recently that you know, and somebody came back and said, hey, we saw him, he's alive. He's dead. That doesn't happen. These guys were not predisposed to believe in a resurrection. They were skeptical at first, just like people are today. In the Gospel of John, after Jesus does appear to the disciples, who's the guy that he appears to after the rest of the disciples? He wasn't there the first time. Thomas. Thomas comes on the scene after Jesus appears to the disciples the first time. And what does Thomas say? Okay. What George Bush tried to say once, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Bush didn't get it out, but that's the phrase. Okay, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Thomas said, I'm not going to be taken in by this again. No way. And then, of course, Jesus appears to him, and this good Jewish guy ends up bowing down and saying, my Lord and my God, to somebody that he experienced life with. Jewish guys don't say, my Lord and my God, to a man. Thomas was convinced that Jesus was who he said he was through his resurrection. It will always be met with skepticism. I've met it with skepticism, so have you. Part of the reason I show this stuff up here is to bring these events a little bit to life for us, so that they don't just become little depictions, little pictures that we've seen in Sunday school, you know, 40 years ago or 50 years ago or however long it is for those of us who went to Sunday school when we were little. Now, when you go to the actual sites, there are places there. It is firmly rooted in history, in time and space. When we say Jesus rose from the dead, the body that went into the grave came out of the grave, but in a way that nobody would have expected or could have made up, because in the resurrection appearances, sometimes he's recognized, sometimes he's not. Why would you say that? If you're trying to make this thing credible, the reason you would say it is because that's the way it went down. And even though you can't explain all of it, you do know that what you saw was real. Jesus went to the depths of saying, okay, Thomas, come here. Put your hand here. Put your hand here. Do not be unbelieving anymore, but believing. If this is what it takes for you, believe. Believe. It will always be met with skepticism. You know what? The way that we can show the word, you know, what's the best way that believers in Christ can show people who don't believe in Christ that it's real according to the Bible? What's the best thing we can do? Class? A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples. Substitute the word Christian there, because Christian and disciple means the same thing. Did you know Christian is only used 3 times in the New Testament? Disciple is used several dozen times. By this, everyone will know that you are a Christian disciple if you have love for one another. The best evidence that Jesus is alive is how we act towards one another. Isn't that interesting? There's another way. And that is by showing our unity with people, with others from who proclaim Christ. And so that's the best thing we can do. Now, we can also talk about evidences for the resurrection, which I love to do. But the best way is for us to love one another. Jesus was not above proving his resurrection. And that gives me encouragement, because he knows there's something about me that needs that. At least there was about me. I'll tell a little bit later here. But He submitted to it. He says, come and check it out. It will always be met with skepticism. But if you're one of those who have met it with skepticism, I want you to promise me to do one thing. That you will read at least one book that defends the resurrection, rather than a bunch of books that actually, well, I'll get that in a little bit. Read at least one, okay, by a scholar who supports the resurrection, if that's what you're prone to. There are out there plenty of evidence you can go to, and I'll give you a few if you want. Third point is this. Anyone is invited to investigate the facts and draw conclusions. Luke mentions Peter here, but Peter rose and ran to the tomb. Now, we also know from the Gospel of John that John joined him, all right? Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. Okay, Peter was with the disciples when the women came and began to talk crazy. But he did something about it. And again, we know from John 20 that John joined him in this run from where they were to the site of the crucifixion, resurrection. And it wasn't far, maybe a quarter of a mile. So they ran there. They ran to check the evidence. What they saw was an empty tomb. And here it says that Peter went away marveling. It doesn't say that he was totally convinced at this point, but he certainly knew something was going on. And he knew he hadn't taken the body out of there. So there had to be some explanation for it. Some people take more convincing than others. It says in John, it says that John saw the same thing Peter saw, and he believed. In other words, it all came back to John a little quicker than it did to Peter. We know from 1 Corinthians 15 that later on Jesus appeared to Peter and the rest of the apostles too. And so Luke writes about that. for me, as an 18-year-old young college student who had grown up in the church, grew up in it, everything I believed, right? I had great parents. I have five older brothers. All of them were influential to me in some way or another. Come from a large family. And yet, at the age of 18, I was in a philosophy class, my first year of college. And there was a guy in there who was also a Christian, but I couldn't stand him. He just embarrassed me. I don't know how else to say it. But I wish I'd had his courage, his spunk, his chutzpah, because he was doing stuff I never would have dreamed of doing. I just didn't like the way he was doing it. And he had this other group of people over here who would just kind of mock him. And I would say, all right, there's got to be a better way to do this. But then it went even further than that for me. It was, why do I believe this stuff? Why do I believe that Jesus is Savior? Why do I believe that his death took my sins away? Why do I believe in his resurrection? Is it just because everybody in my life important to me believes it? Because my mommy and daddy believe it? Is that why? Dawned on me that that's not really a great answer. And at the age of 18, I determined, I'm going to figure this out. I can't go on any longer just kind of writing off the faith of others. And folks, by the way, that's true of each one of us. You cannot coast on the faith of someone else. It's got to be your own. You know, one of the amazing things my dad always told me is, man, I wish I could believe for you, but I know I can't. And then having my own children, I realized I can't have an encounter with Jesus for them. It's one of the most, it's a frustrating thing, and yet that's how it is, right? We must come to grips with this in a personal way. And I knew that I needed to. And so I started reading. And one of the books I encountered, and it's still out there, and it's still one of the best I've ever read on evidence for the resurrection, was written in the 30s by a British lawyer named Frank Morrison, who set out to, and it was very trendy in his day, to write about the life of Jesus but take away the supernatural stuff. All right, let's get down to the essence of the real Jesus, the historical Jesus. Obviously, we have to take this mumbo jumbo of resurrection and miracles out of the picture so we can get to the kernel of the real guy. And that was a very trendy thing to do in the turn of the 20th century and in the early decades of the 20th century. And so that's what he set out to do. However, he had some respect for the Gospels, especially the Gospel of Mark, because he considered it the earliest. And so he took that and other historical things, and he started to write this story about the last week of the life of Jesus to try to explain how a crucified individual could inspire a worldwide movement that happened during the first century. What happened? How in the world did it go from that to what it became? And as he began to look at the evidence and the facts, he just started to, and he finally came to the belief that the only thing that explains the explosive rise of Christianity in the first century is because of the resurrection that happened. There's no other explanation for that. It either was a real resurrection, or these guys certainly thought they had seen a real risen body. Not just a spiritual essence. Oh yes, Jesus, his spirit still lives today. That's you would never see a first century Christian or gospel writer saying that kind of a nonsensical thing. It would not have inspired them at all. We hear that all the time today. Well, yes, Jesus rose in the sense that his spirit still lives with us. That's not what they were saying. These guys were saying the body went in the ground, and then a body came out, and the tomb is empty, and the body that came out was kind of like the one that went in, but it was different. It was transformed in some way. Closest I think we can get to it is a butterfly. A caterpillar goes in the cocoon, something happens in there, and a butterfly comes out. The cocoon is empty, and there's continuity between the caterpillar and the butterfly, but holy cow, what a difference. And we're told by Paul in 1 Corinthians that all of those who are in Christ get to experience the same kind of transformation. So there was continuity, But the body was different. By the way, a great a British theologian by the name of N.T. Wright said, no religion, Jewish or otherwise, conceived of a resurrection in those terms. It was totally surprised that a resurrection would happen like that. But that's what we have. And for me, the evidence was compelling and convincing, and I was convinced. I was convinced. Final point, real quickly, is this. According to the Apostle Paul, the stakes are high concerning the truth or falsehood of the resurrection. Here's what Paul writes in the greatest chapter on the resurrection in all of Scripture, 1 Corinthians 15. For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless, and your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the dead, but that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. Now, if I'd ask you to summarize that in one sentence, you very astutely would say, what Paul is saying is that there must be a resurrection of the dead, generally, because Jesus was raised from the dead. And if he hasn't been raised from the dead, I should go back to Tarsus and resume my tent-making career. That's the logic of it. The stakes are high. This is not just an appendage to Christianity. This isn't a nice thing we say on Easter. It's not just a few appropriate words we say at a funeral of a believer, just because they sound nice and to kind of soften the blow a little bit. This is foundational to our faith. The resurrection of Jesus cannot be ignored. It's been proclaimed as true now for over 2,000 years, and one must choose to believe it or not. Do you understand that? There can be no middle ground here. There can be none of this patronizing stuff about saying, well, the Spirit is with us, because that's not what these guys were saying. There's no neutral ground. If it's true, it means eternal life for all who believe. If it's false, then Jesus was nothing more than a nice guy who met a really bad end. The resurrection proves that Jesus keeps his promises. It's also something that's hard to believe, and we know that it needs evidence, and many people need that. I needed it, and so we invite others to explore the evidence. But above all, we must understand what it means for everyone who says they believe. Now listen to me carefully as I close. It means everything if it's true. Would you agree with that? It means everything if it's true. It means nothing if it's not true. If the resurrection is true, and you believe it's true, and that Jesus calls you to believe in him, to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow him, and you believe that he said and meant this, then why in the name of God are so many of us living our lives as if he's still dead? Why do we believe something as amazing as the resurrection and go home today as if we've heard nothing? For God's sake, what can be more important to do something with our lives than this? Are you called by Jesus to be his disciple where he's placed you in whatever occupation he has placed you? If he has, and if the resurrection happened, doesn't that change the whole dynamic for you and for me? Is that not logical? It either means everything or it means nothing at all. If it means everything, then let's go from here and live like it means everything. There can be nothing better we can do with our lives than serve Jesus, who died for us and rose from the dead. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that God made him sin who knew no sin, so that what? So that you and I could be made the righteousness of God. Jesus became something he wasn't so that you and I could become something we aren't. He became sin. It didn't just say he was like sin. He became sin. Every disgusting thing you read in the paper, Jesus became. The most pure life ever lived became that. Absorbed in himself the whole wrath of God, God's determination to do away with sin and evil forever. That's what Jesus absorbed on the cross. That was what was messing him up so much in the Garden of Gethsemane. He became sin so that you and I could become righteousness of God. It's an amazing story. It's an amazing story. And if it's true, it means everything. Don't leave here today mildly agreeing with it. There's no mildness about any of this. It certainly wasn't to the disciples then. How can it be for us now? If we believe it. The band comes up, next steps. If you're a skeptic, and believe me, I understand if you are. I get it. If you're a skeptic, do your due diligence. Do what Frank Morrison did. Do what I did. Do what thousands of people have done. And get some of your questions answered. But please read everybody. By the way, I've read skeptics too. The best the skeptics can do is kind of call us names and call us silly for believing this sort of thing. But I have not seen one skeptic give any real evidence that really counters the resurrection of Jesus. I just haven't seen it. Maybe you can point it out to me. If you're a skeptic, do your due diligence. If you're a believer, then let the resurrection assure you of your faith, and then for God's sake, go live like it. All right? Okay, Ben, go ahead and